Dr. John Nason is going to be introducing us to 3D printing cranio-maxillofacial surgery, an asset or an expense. So it's about perspective. We can either look at something as an expense, meaning money going out of your pocket and giving you pain, or look at it as an asset, as an investment, which gives you pleasure. We all want pleasure and move away from pain. So with that note, I want to request you all a hearty round of applause and help us welcome Dr. John Nason on stage. Thank you.
I'm basically, so I'll cut myself short. I'm Dr. John, I'm a maxillofacial surgeon. I'm here to basically talk about, is this the right time for 3D printing? Are we there? I mean, we all talked about when we started in 2014, when I started. I mean, I've been in 3D printing for the last almost 14 years right now. And so we said, I mean, my dad, when I started the company, said, John, I mean, why are you getting into toys? No, why are you getting into models? And when is this going to become a reality? I'm happy today to see doctors like Dr. Mahesh, a doctor like the orthopedic doctor who's talking about so many life-changing things. That's where the medical applications is. That's where 3D printing is. Can it change lives? When you talk about medicine, can it make a change? But are we there yet? I believe we are just about in the second or the third step. We are just about 5% of what the potential is for 3D printing is. And there's much, much more that we can do. And I'm glad engineers, designers, and doctors are sitting together here to see how we can collaborate and innovate. So I'm just going to show you a video of a case that we did, where I thought, okay, let's make use of how we can see if can we do 3D printing a little bit more. Can we stretch it just beyond the fact of us doing prototypes? So 3D printed patient-specific implants. So this was done at King Ahmed Hospital. This lady came to this hospital with a large swelling. So I didn't see the patient. The doctor there said, from Baron John, this is a case of ameloblastoma. Luckily, that's a benign tumor. So he said, can we work on this? So I said, yes, let's do a model first. So this was a large model with such a huge lesion on this patient. The options were, do a fibula, take bone and put it from another place. I said, no, let's rule that out. Let's do the whole thing with 3D printing. So we did prototypes, we did the whole virtual simulation, and we 3D printed the implant over here. But can you actually do that? Can you do that? So we tried, and by God's grace, and it worked. So this is the surgery that was done. And that's the large tumor that the patient removed. Not as large as what showed, but something very similar to this, smaller version of that. Yeah, just play it, boss. And because the implant was adapted well, so the doctor didn't do anything at all over this. All he did was just open it, placed it, screws it, and put in the graft over there. And this is the way the patient looks post-op. That's the x-ray, sorry. And this is how it adapts over there. And that's the patient's face. Now this is what I call game changer. Otherwise, this patient would have been in the hospital, ICU, 6 months before she has to come back to work, to routine work. Not possible at all. Today, admission, surgery, and then you're exiting the patient on the third day or the fourth day. That's a game changer. That's where technology is moving. And that's where I think we are standing at the forefront. But now the presentation on. So this is how advanced technology can go on. And this is just one of the few cases that we did. And it doesn't have to be purely in India. You can be anywhere in the world and still do it. So I'll just run on a lot of, I won't do the usual ones because, I mean, I think everybody's covered on that. This was plastic surgery, the way they started it. The only problem with plastic was they never looked at, I hope there are no plastic surgeons here. Aesthetics was always the last choice. I mean, because you were looking at restoring the patient's jaws, restoring the anatomy. Aesthetics was last. But today, we can change that. The way we operate is also changing. Like what most of the doctors showed you, it's making the doctor's life more simpler. Today, with prototypes, with guides, with custom-made implants, how would you handle a case like this? Conventional means would take, you would use a standard mesh and then adapt it and put it. Those are changing. How do you handle a case like this? Not just gross cases. This is what something that you saw. Symmetry is like this. Okay? And I'm glad we're in a technology which is not just going to be out in the next few years, but it's here to stay. But where we come across in the four main uses are, this is what we looked at. Tooling, prototypes, custom-made implants, and last is bioprinting. Eventually, we need to go there. And because of good diagnostic tools that we have, good simulation techniques. I mean, I'm glad our speaker before talked on simulation, because that's where we need to go in. Today, taking a scan and doing a model is child's play. Believe me, it's child's play. If you think you're going to start your company with doing that, guys, you're outdated, man. Today, we need to start looking at simulations. People are talking in virtual reality. People are talking in augmented reality. So prototype model is the last on the list. And I think we as a company in STARS, we're trying to tell the doctors, don't do prototypes. Guys, go virtual. So what are you going to do with so much of junk of plastic with you? That's a biohazard, right? That's ABS and PLA, right? Now we say, so doctors, go virtual. Start looking at it virtual. Start using the HoloLens. Start seeing 3D. Go into immersion technology. That's where we want to push doctors into. That's what our ultimate aim is. Now, 3D models for life, these are things that we can do. Designing, haptics. We use the haptics extensively for my designs, so that we use on 3D printing. And virtual simulation. How do you move? How do you plan for a person to move his jaw, this is a class 3, from there to here? Simulation. Today, our patients also want to see, you're talking on 3D, doc, what are you doing? Is this make sense? Our colleagues in the other department say, you guys are talking on 3D, what does it actually do? Because eventually, you end up having only a model with you, right? That's not 3D, yes. That's only one small part of 3D. 3D is more to that. Simulation. Now, this is now we started on joints. I guess even Sudhakar also showed a couple of joints. There are only 4 or 5 major companies in the world doing temporomandibular joints. And by God's grace, we are one of the first Indian companies to get authorized by the Indian TMJ Association to start doing joints. And believe me, the joints that we do here, okay, these kinds of joints, conventionally companies like Zimmer Biomed and Johnson & Johnson would charge you, the market price today is about 1.8 lakhs, single site. Today, we are able to give it to hospitals at the rate of 75,000 rupees, with still a margin for us. That's 3D printing. We want to be able to bring it to 50,000. I mean, you don't want to obviously sell it too cheap, right, guys? We want to bring it to a cost level where more and more people can be using it. That is where we want to come to. So, but for us to do that, we need a lot of standardization. We just don't want any Tom, Dick, and Harry to start printing. There has to be certain ethics in when you start printing for patients to be placed inside. So that's where the community comes. That's where I think with Mansingh Pawar sirs, with Dr. Jayesh Balari, with Vikram, with Shibu, 3D Pera is going to be there as a governing body, which is going to streamline these activities. So we want you all, hopefully, to be part of this group also, so that you can see what's happening on the latest trends. So this is a facial asymmetry. Very common we do this. Conventionally, doctors would do only surgery and then leave it. But how do we move from there to here? So this is just, so we do the whole planning. Today, we're able to give guides for doctors even for cutting. Okay, so that's the cutting edge. So which means that when you do we call it differential. Okay, it's not big rocket science. If you're going to cut straight, it's very easy, right? You just cut it, you keep a guide. But what if you want to cut on one side 2 millimeter, on the other side you want to cut 4 millimeter? Guide helps. Okay, so these guides is something that we form. We got the asymmetry corrected, moved it. So the whole thing is simulated. So the doctor gets to see what he wants to achieve much before he actually does that. That's where we want to go. And imagine the earlier way of doing it was you would take a model, the doctors would do it on the cast or a 3D printed model, cut the model, move the model, show it over there. Boss, those are, you're wasting your time. So that's where we are. And once we realize this is it, this is the big defect that was there. So how do you compensate that? Do a joint. This patient is something that we did. And just wanted to show you, see that's how well it adapts itself. And that's the post-op case there. And that's the case. And these are the different joints that you have. So creativity is thinking of new things. Innovation is doing new things. I'm not here to do this. I'm here actually to talk about what are the challenges. Virtual reality is something that we need to start going into, and virtual reality, OT, mobile augmentation. So the future actually is in our hands. So what are the challenges? The main challenge that I'm talking here is the challenge with applications. There are so many applications that are not yet touched. We have not even touched malignant tumors. We are only at benign tumor stage. Malignance, we always have an issue. That's where material sciences plays a very, very important role. So I was glad when our friend showed us that there is an antibacterial property which is coming in. But that's an interesting step. We are very closely with Dr. Jayesh, but I'm saying, sir, please give me something that I can use for my malignant market. Because the market for PSIs is, if you look at 100%, benign is only about 2-3%. That's where we are all fighting. There is a still 95% market with malignant tumors, which is not touched. Because an ideal surgeon, what he would do, he would resect it and leave it. Because you can't put titanium over there, right? So what are the new materials? We're talking on PEEK, we're talking on bioceramics. That's where we need to go to. The market is big. India is a huge market, guys. Believe me, India is huge. There's enough of market size in medical application for even for double the size of audience is going to start companies tomorrow. There is enough, much, much more enough, I tell you that. But that's a market we need to look at. Regulations and technology. Technology is not cheap. Yes, technology is not cheap. There are lots of freewares, but you guys, if you want to do something good, you need to invest. So the advantages, yes, it's more accurate. Diagnostic is good. Time, it saves a lot of time. Need for elaborate extensive laboratory work is cut out. And assistance free of simulation. The limitations are technical know-how. You need to really, I work with a team of engineers with me. So I have a team of about 5 engineers. We have 2 surgeons who work with me, doctors in my own company called STARS. We have now Vikram who's also helping us out. Shibu helps us a lot with respect to building the market. That's a collaboration that we need to work on. Because as an individual, I tell you, when we started, we were zero. I mean, it's an ocean that you're swimming against. But as a team, we can do great things. Software, hardware, that was my biggest challenge. So, I mean, yes, you have companies like Materialize, your company 3D Systems, but shelling out that kind of money is not like draining you dry. But so if software can come up, you can develop new software. So 3D Systems and whole ecosystem is just not about doing cases, and it's the whole ecosystem as such. Designing the tool, getting a software, getting the hardware, getting the right product, getting it into the market. So that's the whole ecosystem that works on 3D printing. And then yes, cost. So opportunities are great. It depends on this. This is something which I saw recently because I go a lot for medical applications for a 3D printed metal company. And they said, everybody says, John, now you are into customization. Now what's the regulation on customization? So we talked with a lot of regulators also about custom made implants. So this is what we found, what I found, because that gives me a leeway space. Anybody is working on customization, as the onus is on the doctor. So let's be very, very clear about it. The onus is purely on the surgeon, as long as you guys have your documentation right. But that doesn't mean you can take an implant from a small home-based work and take it and put it on the patient. No. The implant that comes in, the product, like Sudhakar was explaining, the product is certified. The product is an FDA certified. The process needs to be certified. Believe me, it needs to be certified. So if you have a company, you're going to start, you're associating with a company, if it's not certified, boss, you have a problem. You need to get into the ISO certification. 13485 is a certification for process. The product, so far, now we have a leeway space. In custom implants, we have a leeway space. But if you're going to get into regular stock implants, there's a whole cycle about it. Even in the US market, Trump has a new rule now which states that for a single-use implant, you have a leeway. You just need to get the doctor and the hospital to sign for you to get an implant inside. We are working with the FDA in the US to get into the US market now because we are now into joints. I mean, we started working on joints. Just to show you the market, we started working on TM joints only for the past 2 months now. And as of today, this is October we started. November 29th, we have finished 14 joints. Just for you, not for my pride, just to show you that's the market for temporomandibular joints alone. We have done about 157 custom-made implants. So, and it all, if you look at it, 2014 we started nothing. 15, one implant a year. 16, we did 5 implants in a year. 17, we did maximum, I think we've done about 8 implants in a year. 19 and 20, we are doing now, we're doing close to about 12 implants a month. That's the market. And people are accepting it today. So today, no longer people are bargaining with us. Doctors are not bargaining with us. Because yes, people know that it is done, it is proven, it is staying. There is a 3-year, we have a 3.5-year study on custom-made implant. It works. Guys, it works. If it doesn't work, it's a mistake purely on the designing process or on the manufacturing process or on the surgeon who placed it because he didn't stick to plan. So it's not always the manufacturing. Sometimes the doctors can make mistakes. I have placed implant myself on one of the patients and it failed. It failed because I didn't plan properly. It can happen. So that's where we are. So this is a leeway space that we have and we can obviously make use of it. So it's not about ideas, it's actually making the ideas happen. So that's it. So there's a long way to go and I'm glad we are part of the association and really thanks Shibu for it. There's so much that we can do. We just need to start connecting together, connect the dots, work with each other. I was talking with Mahesh also. I said, Mahesh, I'm a maxillofacial. I don't touch anything other below the neck. Okay, because if somebody is good in that, we give it to them. Okay, boss, this is it. So we like to keep to our areas. That way we excel, be the best in what we do. Thank you very much.
So thank you, Dr. John Nason. Really appreciate the information and knowledge that you have imparted today to our audience. They greatly appreciate it. Now, we're going to take Q&A, or questions and answers. However, those questions and answers have got to be short and concise. If it is going to be elaborative, meaning for a lengthier period of time, in the interest of time, you all can hold on to the questions, connect with the speakers and the presenters, and get clarity on your question. So if the questions are short or you feel it's going to be quick, then we can go through it right now.
Dr. Mahesh. Mahesh, what's the youngest patient that you've operated with 3D assisted?
Can we have a provide mic? Dr. Mahesh?
How young right can we, you know, like can visit? So which means that it shows on 3D, you can actually see it on 3D for a 1 month old.
Now we are going to the fetus.
I recommend use the mic so that everybody benefits.
In fact, now we are going on to the fetus.
Oh.
So that would be again a game changer if you're able to look at fetal hearts because you have the capability of upscaling it to any scale,
yeah.
Right?
Okay.
So what we need is an excellent 3D data set. Provided we have an excellent 3D data set, it's possible for us to print. So the youngest baby we did was actually the third child we ever printed and it was a very complex heart disease called the crisscross heart.
Okay.
And it was purely the anatomy that was shown on the print which made the big difference because it's very difficult to figure out anatomy.
Yeah. That's a challenge because I truly agree with what you said because most cardiothoracic people that we have met said, John, pediatric. But is there a difference in the anatomy between what you actually see on the pediatric scan and actually when you go in and when you operate? Is there a change or is it exactly what you see on scan is what you find?
So the scans, particularly with a soft tissue structure like heart or the blood vessels, it's sometimes, and especially with congenital heart disease, it can be very difficult to figure out because there can be such a wide range of complexities. So when we're looking at scans, we are looking at 3D data, but we're looking at it on a 2D screen moving through slices. One CT scan or an MRI scan have up to 400, 500 slices of information.
Yeah.
So you're going through it slice by slice. So the viewer or the doctor is supposed to imagine the three-dimensional anatomy in his own brain.
Okay.
And that's where the skill of an imager is.
Yeah.
But then, even then, understanding that and conveying that to the surgeon is going to be very difficult. So through conventional means, it's quite often for surgeons to have surprises on table.
Correct.
But exactly. If you're able to get a print or a virtual visualization, like you said, in many cases, we just do a virtual visualization, not even physically 3D print it out.
Correct.
But we are able to march through the heart, go through the blood vessels. That really imparts much better understanding. And we have never had an instance where the 3D printed anatomy was even a little different from the intraoperative anatomy. And we've validated that in case after case.
Thank you, Doc. Thank you. Sudhakar, sir. Now, with respect to the powders that we give, Sudhakar, no, titanium. Now, does it come with the certification? You see, how does EOS help? Let's say I want to start a company. I want to get into metal. So, what would the steps that you take very briefly and approximately what it would cost? Because ultimately, we need to look at that, right?
Yeah, all the materials comes with the mill test certificate. So, this is something which gives you the composition of the material.
So, who gives this?
EOS gives you.
So,
every batch of the powder, even if the batch changes, we do give that mill test certificate for that particular batch.
But is that medical grade certified?
Yeah, it's a medical grade. There is a separate medical grade called titanium ELI.
Yes.
Which is the medical grade titanium.
Yeah, that's the one approved.
So, every batch has a mill test certificate and it is getting certified for that particular batch. Yeah, the certificate is given is an FDA one. Yeah, it's an FDA certificate, yeah. So that's what I was telling about. It's the material. Yeah, along with that, it gives you a medical FDA certificate also is that.
Okay.
The MILT certificate has
no,
everything.
Because SLM gives you an FDA certification. GE powders also give you an FDA. That's what I was asking. So is this an FDA certified?
It also has information again, other than that with the grain size, the melting granulary size and all that stuff.
That's okay.
Yes,
that's
great. Yes,
okay.
Yes.
And costings, approximately. Just a rough figure.
This should cost about per kg around 170 euros.
Okay.
Roughly. Right.
And yours is it's a DMLS tech.
Yeah, it's a direct metal laser sintering.
All right, okay. I think a lot of materials today are being done with DMLS. And so support system that are being generated, right?
Yes, right? Metal has a support system, so you can't do a stacking.
So which means that adds to the cost of the product?
It's about 15 to 20% of the part. Again, we can do a lot of orientation. That's where the data preparation comes up. So that's where we come up and we have a lot of, because we have been in this field for 30 years,
okay.
So we know how to orient the metal, the part in such a way that you get the support structures very less. And we also have developed the process parameters for the support structures so that it doesn't take too much of material. And the post-processing, like removing this material, the supports are easier.
It might become much easier.
Yes.
Okay. Any other questions anybody wants to ask? Yes, sir.
In dental application, there are some polymers coming for directly printing aligners.
Yeah.
So, to get this aligners to be certified
No. Aligners, today, I mean, yes, Invisalign was the only guy who had the patent technology for us doing aligners. Today, we use the same thing. You can do it with Formlabs for 3/4 the cost. But the only thing is, you need to use a dental approved resin to print it. That's the only thing. Because you print, there are two options. One, what Invisalign does is, Invisalign prints the aligner itself directly. What we do with 3D printing now is you print the mold and then you use silicone on top and thermoform it.
Yeah, that
correct.
Yeah.
So now the thermoform is only needs to be certified. It depends on what silicone you use. Now, if that's a dental approved medical silicone, no problem. Because, and it's not internal, right? It's only going to be used. So, which means that you're not worried about a lot of toxic content, but it shouldn't harm the patient, cause taste, it shouldn't melt in the mouth, and those kinds of things should not happen. Which, like our crowns, like how we have our crowns and our dentures, right? So, those same properties, if they're dental, it's fine. You can start using it, no problem.
Yeah, so we can print directly aligners.
Yes, you can.
And then directly,
you're printing for your patient, right? Or if you want to do it as a company, great, you can do it. You don't need a certification for it.
Okay, because you know we can save a lot of
100%, yes.
Material,
yeah,
for
we also have that, but that was not a core area of expertise, so we didn't want to proceed with that. But then yes, there are in Bombay there are two companies who do that. There's a company called Flash Orthodontics who does that. There is a company in Bangalore. I mean, lots of companies do it, man. Lots of companies in India.
I'll connect with you offline. Thank you.
You can start your for a budget of 7 lakhs, you can have your own aligner company. 7 lakhs.
Thank you.
Fantastic.
Done.
So, we'll conclude this now in the interest of time. As I've said, if there is any elaborative issues, by all means, utilize the time later. Now, I'm going to call on two gentlemen here. This is the interest of time again. Dr. Sanjay Gupta, can you identify yourself here, please? Dr. Sanjay Gupta. Dr. Jayesh Pillare, if you can do me a favor, hand him the presentation now. Done? Because the thing is, we are really tight in time. So now we'll be doing the citations. I'll be inviting Dr. Shibu John on stage for showing or expressing a gesture of appreciation to the presenters who've invested their skill and talent to impart this information to the audience. Dr. Shibu John, join me on the stage, please. Thank you. A round of applause, please. So I'll be calling out the names of the participants, and if you can be so kind enough to join us on the stage here so that Dr. Shibu John can honor you, is going to be really appreciated and great. So Dr. Mansingh Pawar, please. Music, please. Dr. D.K. Sharma. Dr. M.S. Senthil. And also, if you all can express your gesture of appreciation for the speakers with a soft round of applause. The word is soft. Mr. Anand Prakasham. Mr. Anand Prakasham. Dr. John Nason. Dr. Kalyanan Kanian. Daniel Martinez. Daniel Martinez. Dr. Mahesh. Mr. Sai Santosh. I believe Mr. G.L. Sudhakar has already... Okay, come on. Okay, G.L. Sudhakar. Dr. John Nason. Thank you. So that brings the citation to conclude. Are we concluding the citations? Thank you, Dr. Shibu John. Thank you to all the participants expressing appreciation here. And now we begin the session of Design and Manufacturing Aerospace Defense or Automobile Tools, Oil and Gas, Energy Packaging, Material with DFAM and Software Simulation. So I'd like to call upon the first presenter, which is Mr. Saket Kalra. Mr. Saket Kalra, please kindly make your way to the stage. A round of applause, music please.
Good afternoon, and I am Saket Kalra, and I belong to Honda Cars India Limited, and we are stationed at the GNU plant, which is the Greater Noida in UP, very near to Delhi. So today I am here to present our journey of 3D printing, its transformation of technical endeavor into scale up. So this is the agenda of my presentation, and starting with the introduction of the company, then to the journey and the key learnings and the way forward. So very different kind of a presentation from what we have seen since morning, a very conventional one, sorry. So starting with the introduction, we established one plant in 1995 in Greater Noida and the other in 2008 in Tapukara, Rajasthan. We have automobiles as our products, and Honda share is 100%. We have almost 9,000 employees working, and our capacity is 2.8 lakh vehicles put together for both the plants. And this is the product range, starting from City, Civic, Accord, CRV, etc. And we have 10 lakh customers and ever growing, happy ones. Ours is a philosophy driven company. We have a very, very strong philosophy, respect for the individual. And the vision is to be a company that the society wants to exist. So as a member of the community, Honda seeks to create value for the society and bring joy to the people's lives. So we do a number of activities in the CSR area, mainly in healthcare and education. So this is the glimpse of the various health camps that we have conducted, and we do them near our plants, both the plants, and almost 2,500 beneficiaries in 2019. Apart from this, we work a lot with the education part, again in the villages. This is one of the villages in Greater Noida, which is called Pali. As you can see the condition of the school, and this is how we have transformed. Apart from the infrastructure, we even, you know, participate in the education part, building the softer skills. So now coming to our journey of 3D printing. We started with basically we use a lot of jigs for manufacturing the automobiles, and these are some of them in the various departments like welding, assembly, plastics and paint, and some of them are really heavy and cost intensive also. So we wanted to make them more easy to use, make them lighter, and of course reduce the cost. So during that exploration, we came across this technology of 3D and attended a few seminars. And then we, you know, understood that yes, we could use 3D technology for making our jigs and fixtures also. And since welding jigs are one of the heaviest, most difficult to use, and of course costly, so we decided on trying it out first in the welding department. And these are the jigs that we use in the welding department. The apertures, which are used to simulate the assembly conditions. The inspection jigs, which are used to ensure the critical pitch. Then the fitment jigs for accurately guiding the fasteners. and the welding jigs, which are basically utilized to put the sheet metals together so that we can make a sub-assembly. So inspection jigs being the most critical accuracy point of view also, so we decided let's try and this. So we made this headlight jig. You know, it matches the pitches whether it's accurate or not, because otherwise the parts won't fit in the assembly line. So when we checked it on the various parameters of safety, management, cost, quality and delivery, it was a hit for us. So based on this encouraging results, we thought of, you know, sorry. We thought of horizontally deploying it to the other welding jigs. And these are the jigs that we utilize them for. These are used for the windscreen, the tail light, the headlight, and the doors, of course. Again, when we checked the benefits that would, we could reap out of it, then the weight was reduced by almost 70%. And the accuracy was within 0.1 mm, which is pretty good. The overall cost reduced by almost 50%. That includes manpower cost also. And the lead time from around 2 months that we used to take for conventional ones, we brought it down to 2 to 3 days. And because of all this, the motivation was also very high, because the technicians who work on the shop floor, they have to lift these jigs and work day in and day out. So that led to a lot of very high motivation. So because of all these encouraging results, our operations head, Mr. Taleb, he thought that why shouldn't we, you know, convert this technical endeavor into a skill up one? Why shouldn't we develop our people and make them, you know, capable of building their own ideas, basically designing, thinking, again checking it out and improving. So we proposed the 3D printer to him, and we, apart from making these jigs and fixtures, even for the tools and the kaizens. Kaizens are small improvements that the technicians do on the shop floor. You know, making small improvements on the line for their ease of work. So that could also be done. So we bought this 3D machine. And based on the stringent selection process, we zeroed on a machine and we bought it. And then we trained our people to use it. Somebody in the morning was talking about training. So probably this is one important part. You know, you can get the infrastructure, which of course we have done, but how to use it? So we need to develop those people. So we have worked upon it. And these are just two of the fixtures or the kaizens that have been made by our people to adjust the wiper angle and pull out the dents. So the platform has been created to innovate and find the new. So rest is up to them. During this journey, these were the key learnings, that the new technology introduction at the shop floor helped us a lot in connecting with the people. You know, they are very appreciative now. The associates' morale is very high because they can make their kaizens, they can do it very fast and see the effectiveness and again improve upon it. There are much more possibilities that can be explored, which people are doing. Associates are armed with new skills of designing, which was very, we had a very marathon session of training for our guys for almost a month. There is a culture development through this new technology. We have thinking associates. Why I say thinking associates? It's because now they think how to improve everything each time. And the way forward is that design and development of the prototypes, tools for other departments apart from welding, we are going to do with this. And we are going to study the polished technology for the other parts and even the metal 3D. So thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Shibu, for giving this opportunity to learn a lot amongst this very intelligent gathering. Thanks a lot.
So, I want to thank Saket Kalra for the enlightening information that he's provided us with. Now I'd like to call on Mr. Srinath Ravi Chandran. The topic is 3D printing beyond prototyping. So help me welcome Mr. Srinath, please. Thank you with a round of applause. Music for a moment.
Good afternoon, everyone. Hopefully, this is interesting enough to, you know, wait for lunch for this long. It was a great morning for me in terms of learning on the medical side. Again, this is going to be an engineering side application that we're going to talk about. So I'm Srinath. I'm from a company called Agnikul. And what we make at Agnikul is a small rocket, a rocket that can take 100 kgs to what they call low Earth orbit, which is space, you know, the lower boundaries of space, like where the International Space Station is. So that is that's sort of the scale rendering of the rocket. So just a quick, you know, summary about why this even makes sense before we get into the 3D printing part, right? So I put down the nose cones of some big rockets that are launching today. You can see the PSLV, GSLV, and for those of you who follow launches, Ariane, the Falcons of SpaceX, and so on. And satellites that go in these rockets have become really small. So you can see how small they are in scale. It's like a dot in the bagel of a big bucket, right? So it's all of almost like, if you want to launch a big rocket just for one of these small ones, it's almost like asking for a train for a one passenger. It doesn't make business sense at all. So what do people do? How do small satellites go to space today? They do a forced ride share. That's a schematic from a PSLV mission that actually happened some time ago, C-34 mission. You can see on top here, this is the actual Indian satellite that was supposed to go, and that is a Cartosat. And you have a bunch of small satellites in that colored portion of the image. These satellites had nothing to do with each other and had nothing to do with ISRO, but they had to wait for that rocket to launch, and that rocket was launched, commanded by the big satellite one. So all of this means rideshare is dominated by people who are building big satellites and is not very efficient as far as SpaceTech is concerned. So what does that mean, right? That means this. What takes like 6 months to build, satellites can be that small, right? What takes 6 months to build takes you 2 years to actually put in space, which is a highly inefficient way to go to space. And this is where we come in, right? And what we are saying is, okay, we'll build a small rocket which can launch on demand for small satellites, and you don't need to wait on elaborate rideshare or any rideshare at all. You can have a dedicated vehicle for yourself to space. So that is where this idea started. That is a scale rendering of the vehicle. It's a three-stage rocket, you know, driven by a lot of additive manufacturing, and I'm going to talk about that as we go ahead, right? So just to put it back with where this fits, there's a smaller nose cone in the bottom here, right? So that is a rocket that, the nose cone of the rocket that we are building. So obviously this is a little more to scale. You can attempt doing a dedicated launch for a small satellite with a vehicle like that. So this is how a typical rocket engine looks like, a liquid propulsion driven rocket engine. Now, it is not doing much besides burning fuel and oxygen. You have to carry oxygen to space in a rocket. But the amount of plumbing here, all of this mess of pipes, is basically to regulate the flow, because it has to be extremely precise. There is a startup sequence, there is a shutdown sequence, and usually there is also a mixture ratio control that happens during the flight. And all of that is in this part here. And then you see these rings here, right? For those of you who don't know, a rocket engine is cooled by the fuel itself. You don't have so much mass budget to take coolant with you and separately circulate it around the engine or so on. Of course, there is no air, so it has to be radiatively cooled, or you do something like this. In traditional engines and in this engine, and this engine is about the size of this building. This room, right? So these pipes here are actually welded. This is a flying rocket. In fact, they had a launch like 2 days ago. Ariane 5 had a launch 2 days ago as well. So it's a flying rocket, and that is how these engines are built today. Each of these pipes are carefully made in pieces and then welded on that nozzle. Each of these plumbing connectors are separately fitted, and so on. So this is a highly what you call messy process, and it takes about 12 weeks to make one even after you have perfected it and you have done a bunch of launches. So just want to establish that before we get into what 3D printing can do, right? So we set out at saying that, hey, as a first of all, we are a smaller company, we are a startup, we are not an area and a multi-billion dollar company. And also, why should we look at rocket engine making the way it is looked at here? Because a lot more things are possible, 3D printing is possible, what can we do with that? So that started a journey. So what we started off with is, okay, this is an injector that we made. This is the very first step that we did. This was back in 2017, right? So what this is a one-piece thing. This is used for mixing. So the fuel enters in the bottom, and I'm actually showing it to you up in a reverse direction. This is the output of the nozzle itself. And here the fuel enters, the oxygen enters there, and it mixes and it comes out. There's a lot of geometry in there which I'm not able to share today because I don't want to let out everything. But it's quite a complex geometry. What happens is what they call a counter swirl. So you send two fluids in clockwise and anti-clockwise directions, and they mix, sort of, you know, coming together and shearing each other. This produces a very fine set of you know, drops that will burn easily and efficiently. So first we did this 3D printing of this, right? So in a rocket engine like the one I showed you before, you have about I would say 500, 600 of these, because there are many injector elements on that. So all of that is welded together on a plate, and you can't even see that. That is actually somewhere in here, right? It's going into the wall here. So we then attempted doing the plate itself. I'm showing you here a plastic version of the plate. We have a metal version as well. I didn't want to put that out here now. But you can see that these injectors, we printed in plastic, and all of the fuel parts, everything, were, instead of actually manually welding it, this came out in one piece. So we spent a lot of time in figuring out how to keep the flow path the way it is supposed to be, and at the same time preserve the geometry of the droplet sizes and so on. And that was also possible. So now, typically, this is about, this has 8 injectors, as you can see, right? Each of this is an injector. And then there's a flange, and then there's a pipe. So this is about 20 to 25 pieces, typically, if you do it in a normal way. And now this is one piece here. So that happened. The next thing was, okay, so we have done an injector element and an injector plate for a rocket engine. What else can you do? To start a rocket engine, you need an igniter, right? So like, we tried that one out too. So an igniter is actually a mini version of a rocket engine itself in some sense. It is also burning, you know, fuel and oxygen, but with a spark plug, you can actually ignite it and make it go. So we printed that one too, and the, I think the igniter is also not visible here. The igniter would be the one that is starting at the center here. So that one was also 3D printed. So injector element, injector plate, igniter. And finally, the cooling channels, right? So you remember seeing those channels I was telling you about, the big rings, right? Just to put these ones, right? These are cooling channels. Basically, you're running fuel itself before it passes into the combustion chamber, which is where the combustion happens. You pass fuel around that. So this cooling channels is like, okay, why should it not also be 3D printed, right? And then happened this thing. This is again in plastic I'm showing you, the metal version. I'll show you that later. But so you can see here that all of these are concealed channels, and we had our own design based on our CFD simulations. We were able to come up with a particular geometry of flow channels completely concealed, and again one piece, right? So the combustion chamber and the nozzle, suddenly, instead of becoming thousands of pieces of pipes, cooling pipes running all over, is one piece that comes out from a 3D printer. So this was another thing that was made into one piece. So it is almost like all aspects of a rocket engine can be independently or in some level together 3D printed, right? So that brings us to this one, which is all of it put together, which we have realized now. So this is what is very likely the world's first, or if not at least India's first, one-piece rocket engine. 1,000 parts in this one shot. Everything that I was telling you about, so the injector elements and the injector plate itself is in here. Obviously, this is the plate. I have tilted the image here. So this is the thing. Here you have the combustion chamber. In between, in this, you obviously can't see it here, but there are cooling channels that are running in between. At the center of this, again hidden by this geometry here, is the igniter as well. So I just wanted to share this story that this is possible with 3D printing. This means what, usually takes about 10 to 16 weeks to make and qualify. If you're not doing anything, you're starting from scratch, it'll take you 12 to 16 weeks to say, hey, I have a qualified rocket engine that I can put on my vehicle. This takes 72 hours. So I think that is the, it's almost like when it first time when we printed this, and this was about, about June or something, so about 5-6 months ago, it almost seemed like magic to us. So I really feel like we are still only scratching the surface of 3D printing, and already so much is possible. How this benefits a company like us, so if it's going to take only 3 days or 4 days to make a rocket engine, then the vehicle making time itself is much lesser, because the rocket engine is the most complex part of a rocket. And after that, the rest of the stuff, you can, you know, optimize another process and so on. And we have not yet gone and figured out what other things we can fully 3D print, right? Aerospace and 3D printing, I think they have had this quite a good journey. I've seen a lot of presentations from other suppliers and so on what they can do in aerospace. But it feels like people are only attempting a fewer parts, non-moving parts and so on. This was one attempt to say, okay, can we, the gas temperature inside a rocket engine goes to somewhere around 3200 Kelvin. And if we can design for that, that too, this material is Inconel. And Inconel, as people who deal with Inconel know, is extremely poor conductor actually. In the scheme of things, it's actually pretty bad. But you can do this, right? So that's why we think 3D printing is really, really great. And that is why I even titled the presentation as 3D printing behind, beyond, you know, just prototyping. So this, and that is like, I mean, of course, that image is inverted, but it is incredible that it is even possible today. And I really feel like every time I look at that engine and it is in a facility, I feel like it is just magic. Just for a couple of thoughts, obviously, production flow based on 3D printing would be a great thing to have. And I heard a lot of things about medical side 3D printing, which I did not know about. Aerospace, I myself follow quite, vividly, so I know that stuff. A few things that would be great if people can, you know, really focus on is training people on qualification and standards. This we figured out after quite a bit of thing that NASA had already done it, so we adopted that. That's a good thing. But in other areas, also, how can we bring in Internet of Things into 3D printing, right? Why should two 3D printers not be working together at different parts of the world and building the same thing? Those kind of things should be thought through, and I think there is a lot of scope for that. So with that, I think I would like to end my presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Srinath. Thank you for the enlightening information. Appreciate the same.